Now, back to the Sports Bash on 97.3 ESPN.
All right, Sports Bash Live, 97.3 ESPN, the free mobile app. And, of course, you can watch the show live Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter on our website, 97.3ESPN.com. I see Michael Kasky Bowman is either hanging upside down, or what are you doing over there?
I had my phone down while I was waiting to come on.
MKB's inside the Sixers.
Upside down.
Yeah, I mean, it had me a little dizzy there.
my bad.
Michael Kasky Bowman covers the Sixers for CBS Sports. He covers the NBA as well. And, of course, he, like all guests, appears in the Boardwalk Honda Hotline. Sports Bash brought to you by East Coast Roofing Siding Windows, serving all of South Jersey. If you call, they'll show up online, eastcoastroofing.com. MKB, what it is, man?
What's going on, Mike? How you doing?
All-star break in the books. A little disappointing not to see Joel and Ben. Do you have any idea what their status is for Thursday night? Do we have any clue on whether or not they will be able to play on Thursday or Friday?
It's still up in the air. Everything I've heard so far, they've tested negative each day so far, including yesterday on every test they've taken since. So as long as they continue to test negative, I think they should be – I mean, Thursday is still up in the air, but I don't think it should be an extended situation. They probably should be back by Friday at least.
Now, obviously, they are the number one seed at the All-Star break, but they are not the number one betting seed if you are looking for the favorite right now. Do you agree that they would not be the favorite in the East at this point? They, by the way, from what I saw – were not one, they were not two, they were actually the third best odds in the East.
Yeah, and I think they should have better odds than Milwaukee, but I do understand why the odds makers will put Brooklyn, you know, ahead of them with the way they've been playing. And the fact that the Nets haven't really even had, you know, they've been without Durant, Kyrie was in and out of the lineup, they got James Harden in the middle of that first half of the season, so they haven't even really had the opportunity to develop the chemistry that, you know, they probably will, and they're still a half a game you know, right behind Philly in the standings. So I think when you take all that into account and the fact of, you know, how good those guys are individually, it makes sense that they would be probably the top, you know, the top pick coming out of the East. I do think the Sixers have a better chance than Milwaukee this year, but I have no problem with the Nets being the favorite.
Thoughts on Blake Griffin? Move the needle?
Not much. I mean, I think a little, it's always good when you can get a player of his caliber and his experience to be, you know, just a bench piece. It doesn't hurt the team. But to me, when they that move, it doesn't really didn't address any of their specific needs. They still need some rim protection, you know, big bodies down in the paint. He's not that. And he's obviously not the player that he was in L.A. So I think during the regular season, especially, it'll be beneficial. He'll be able to eat up a lot of minutes. I'm sure it'll, you know, be easier for him with all the great players around him to kind of just fit in and play a role. But I just question how much he'll be able to contribute in the postseason. You know, he's kind of a liability defensively at this point. He's, you know, injuries and things have sapped the athleticism. He struggles to guard quicker perimeter big men. Like I said, he doesn't have the size to bang with a guy like Joel. So, you know, it's a fine move, but I don't feel like they're much closer to a championship with his addition than they were before it.
I know a lot of people keep looking at this matchup, Philly and the Nets, but we think that Philly will have some more pieces, we would imagine, and the Nets likely. But what are some of the trade targets that you have for the Sixers? Some of the names that the Sixers could be that could have their eye on as the deadline approaches in 3 weeks.
Yeah, there's obviously been a couple that have been reported. You know, PJ Tucker from Houston is one that a lot of teams have their eye on. He would fit as, you know, a floor spacing big off the bench that could play with Joel and help with some of the defensive rebounding. Nemanja Bjelica from Sacramento, another big guy that can space the floor and shoot at a high clip. And then, you know, there's a couple others. Obviously, Austin Rivers with the connection that he has with Doc and the fact that he's kind of been forced out of the rotation with the Knicks since, you know, they signed Derrick Rose. He hasn't been playing much. There's obviously a few other guys. Terrence Ross is a name that, you know, I've heard pop up, and that's not the first time they've been interested in Terrence Ross for, you know, a couple of years now. He would be a nice addition off of the bench. And obviously Kyle Lowry is the big one. My man Keith Pompey from the Inquirer reported a few weeks ago that there was some mutual interest there. I think he would be the biggest needle mover, like the biggest name for the Sixers. Otherwise, it would probably be, you know, looking to bolster the bench, add some shooting and some scoring off of the bench to make that playoff push.
Now, over at CBS Sports, Michael Caskey-Blomain, you mentioned P.J. Tucker. You mentioned, obviously, Kyle Lowry, Terrence Ross. But Fournier is an interesting guy who you did not mention here. I think he would be a very intriguing fit on this team.
Yeah, he'd be an excellent fit, Mike. He fits pretty much exactly what the team needs in terms of a guy that obviously can play off ball and knock down shots at a high rate, but also the type of guy you can put the ball in his hands and set a couple screens for, and he has the ability to, you know, generate his own offense, which, you know, to complement Ben and Joel, that's something they would really need. And he's a guy that technically, you know, he could slide right into the starting five there and play off of those guys or come in off of the bench and give them some, you know, production that way. So I'm not sure what the level of interest is based on, you know, how much they'd be asking for him. I know the Magic are open to the idea of trading him. I'm not sure what the asking price would be. But like you said, on paper, he would definitely be, you know, a great addition for what the Sixers need.
Let me ask you how, and you know, this might be just an opinion, but how willing are the Sixers to part with Maxi Thybulle? Are they like, hey, if we know to get better, we have to move one of them? Or are they looking to do more of like, hey, we'll take your contract, couple second round picks, and we want to match salary?
I think there's willingness on their end to make a move like that, Mike. I think obviously Daryl Morey is well aware that if they're going to make any sort of move leading up to this deadline that's going to, you know, really move the needle, they're going to have to part with something. And, you know, it's not going to be Joel. It's not going to be Ben. It's not going to be Tobias. And at that point, other than, you know, future draft picks, all they really have to offer is these, you know, trio of young guys in Maxi, Matisse, or Shake Milton. So, you know, I think that they view it as that there's an open championship, you know, a chance here to get out of the East and potentially, you know, make a run at a championship here. And at that point, you know, to improve it, you got to sacrifice along the margin sometimes. So I think, you know, they're not shopping those guys per se, but if the right deal for, say, as Kyle Lowry presents itself and those, you know, that's the factor that they have to part with one of those guys, I do think they'd be, you know, ready and willing to do so.
Yeah, the problem, like, you're not getting, like, Zach LaVine or someone of that magnitude without, I don't know, just trading Shake Milton and Tyrese Maxey or any two of those guys net you back a player of that magnitude?
I don't think so, Mike, outside of the Kyle Lowry situation, because Kyle's a guy, he's on the last year of his contract. If the Raptors were to move on from him, I do think they would, you know, work with him to find somewhere that he wanted to be. Philadelphia makes sense. And at that point, you know, they're going to lose him probably in free agency anyway, and getting a one or two young guys like that back would be worthwhile. But for a guy like Zach LaVine or Victor Oladipo or some of the other bigger names that might be available, I don't think the Sixers really have enough, you know, and they're obviously, like I said, they're not going to touch Ben or Joel. And outside of those guys, I think they would probably be outbid. So that's why I think Kyle Lowry's the one, you know, the one guy to keep an eye on. If they're willing to part with some of those young guys, I do think the deal could, you know, probably get done.
Right. So the biggest name, the best and biggest name that you think is Lowry. Is there anybody else in that range, or mostly everybody else would be more of a secondary or bench player?
Yeah, Mike. I mean, unless there's some, they pull something out that I'm not seeing, I think the best situation then is that they would just upgrade the bench, bring in a couple guys that can score and put the ball in the basket and, you know, just continue to ride Ben, Joel, and Tobias as much as they have been. I think that's, you know, the most likely scenario outside of landing Lowry.
Yeah, because you know, and then I don't know if you know of any of the buyout names that are going to start appearing, but that's another market that it should be highly competitive and one that the Sixers might be more inclined to go down that road, much like they did a couple of years ago when they went and got Ilyasova and Bellinelli. You know, they went buyout market, and that was maybe the best, you know, group of, you know, best collection that they had.
Yeah, that's another thing that, you know, teams that have a legitimate chance of winning a title or at least making a deep playoff run, like the Sixers do this year, tend to be the teams that, you know, do the best in the buyout market because these veterans are looking for an opportunity to, you know, potentially compete for a title later in the career. So it will be interesting. It's sometimes it comes out of left field. You don't know who's going to be bought out. Obviously, the Andre Drummond situation in Cleveland is one to keep an eye on, but he's not, you know, necessarily a name that the Sixers would be looking to bring in anyway. So I agree there that even if they don't make huge moves at the trade deadline, there is still a chance for improvement through the buyout market. And I think, you know, Brooklyn would be a top team, and so obviously the Lakers and the Clippers as they were last year. And I think the Sixers fit right into that conversation for buyout candidates.
Are you on board with a guy like Ariza? Would he be a guy you'd be interested in? I mean, he hasn't played, but he would be like Iguodala last year.
Yeah, absolutely. A guy like that, I mean, his role would be minimized, obviously, and he brings a lot of experience and a, you know, 3-and-D mentality to the team. It's something that they would need. You know, a couple of veterans like that that could play not even big minutes, 10 minutes in the playoffs that could help turn a game or a series is, you know, that's the kind of a best-case scenario in the buyout market. So Ariza, you know, other guys like that would definitely be, for me, something to keep an eye on.
Yeah, I know it should be interesting. A lot of second-half storylines with the buyouts and the trades. But there's another second-half story, Michael Caskey-Blomain. The Sixers' schedule coming out is pretty brutal.
Yeah. Yeah, they have a tough stretch coming up. And I think that's the reason that there's a little bit of concern, you know, regarding Ben and Joel with having to potentially miss a couple of these early games. Because it starts off, it's not too bad. They play the Knicks. I think the Wizards are their first two games, and the Bulls maybe in you know, in some order right there.
Yeah,
if Bulls, they can start off.
Bulls, Wizards, Spurs, Knicks,
there
Bucks.
You go. So, you know, those first four up until the Bucks are winnable games, and they're not, you know, obviously you would like to have your full complement of players there to pick up wins and to, you know, continue to grow the chemistry. Obviously they ended that first half on a high note with the win against Utah. And in the second half of the season, you want to continue to develop that chemistry. And especially, like you said, once they hit the road for, I think there's almost a 2-week road trip right there after those first few home games. And it's going to be, you know, the Nets are breathing down their neck. I think it's extremely important for the Sixers to finish with at least a top 2 seed in the conference, if not the top overall seed, which, you know, I do think by the end of the season, the Nets will probably overtake the Sixers for that top spot. But the Sixers, to me, really need, you know, home court advantage, and they need to avoid trying potentially facing the Nets in the first two rounds. You know, so to me, that second seed is crucial, and they need these, you know, as many wins as possible.
Yeah, midway through, MKB, how do they match up with Milwaukee?
Yeah, I'm kind of bullish on the Sixers' chances against Milwaukee this season, and even in the past, I think they have, you know, guys that they can throw at Giannis defensively, a multitude. You can put Ben on him for a while. Matisse, Joel could spend, you know, a stretch on him. They have guys to throw at him. And I think, you know, the Bucks don't necessarily have an answer for Joel inside. You know, Lopez is a decent paint defender, but they just don't have an answer for Joel. So I do think that they would fare well against Milwaukee in a series. To me, it's really just the Nets at this point that, you know, could be a problem for Philly.
And your prediction, Joel Embiid, will he be the MVP? First time a center would win since Shaq did it 20 years ago.
I don't want to jinx him. Obviously, Mike, you and I know very well issues he's had with his health in the past that seemed to pop up out of nowhere. But as long as he can stay healthy and play at the, you know, about the same clip of games that he did in the first half, I do believe so. Especially if the Sixers stay up in that top couple seeds in the East. I think that he's, you know, finally realizing the potential that people have seen in him for years, and he's putting together a historic season so far.
Should be fun. Second half begins Thursday night right here on 97.3 ESPN. We'll
yes, sir.
See if now the Sixers have not had fans in the building yet, correct?
That's correct. Sunday against the Spurs, I think, will be the
first
game.
Will be the first time they have fans in the building. All right. So
yeah.
Does that mean you guys are going to have to go back to the crappy seats?
I was wondering the same thing, because I've gotten really used to having the nice tables and all the space to spread out. I'm interested to see what they do with that.
Yeah. Well, we'll see. And fans should be back Sunday night. Sixers, Spurs. They're at Chicago, at Washington, and then home against the Spurs. Fans will be back in the building for the first time this season. MKB is always in the building, and he is kind enough to join us on Inside the Sixers today. Michael, take care, bud.
You too, Mike. Good talking to you.
Yeah, man. It's Michael Caskey-Blomain, and he, like all guests, appeared via the Boardwalk Honda Hotline. And, of course, the Sixers are back Thursday night. We'll have the game for you, all the action, with Tom McGinnis calling the action here on 97.3 ESPN. Trade for Terry Rozier. Yeah, I would.